Who are these descendants of Africans who are scattered throughout the world? What are their stories? What did they contribute to global culture? And why don't we know more about them and their stories? The answers lie in the guilty and painful silences surrounding the more than 1,500 years of history of the enslaving of African peoples in distant lands. Slavery existed throughout the world, and the word slave comes from the Slavic people enslaved in many societies. But in modern times, when most people think of slavery, they think of sub-Saharan Africans and their descendants, enslaved in lands across the Sahara Desert, the Red Sea, and the Indian and Atlantic Oceans.
Le rapport à l'esclavage n'est pas encore totalement éteint. La société est encore plus ou moins marquée par cela, mais en même temps, ce qui est paradoxal, on a l'impression qu'il y a une amnésie. Comment peut-on admettre que nos arrière-parents, nos grands-parents et que nos ancêtres ont pu, en effet, réduire des êtres humains à une simple marchandise, à une simple, donc un simple outil de travail. Et on vit encore aujourd'hui avec ce malaise qui déchue, qui parfois exprimé, parfois tue, souvent tue.
À cause du silence, l'esclavage est un vaste territoire d'ignorance. Bien, tout cela, à mon avis, est un gain. De savoir ce qu'on ne sait pas est un gain.
The slave trades that literally changed the face of the world were not the first great migration out of Africa. The first African diaspora was the migration of the ancestors of all of humankind who 100 to 150,000 years ago spread out from Africa to people the rest of the earth.
It's a mistake to think that there was only one African diaspora, that the African diaspora is associated only with the slave trade. Africa was the cradle of humankind. And that consisted of millions of individuals as well who went up to Europe and who went to Asia. What is important about this movement is that it was not coerced, it had nothing to do with racial prejudice of one sort or the other.
Si on limite l'apport africain à ses routes de l'esclavage, on commet une erreur historique, une erreur humaine et une erreur idéologique. Et c'est dans ce sens que revoir cette histoire, c'est la refondre, c'est la refonder dans cette vision, je dirais sur la très longue durée, la vision humaine du substrat africain de notre société.
The massive long-distance deportation of enslaved Africans began more than 1,500 years ago with the trans-Saharan slave trade and the trade around the Red Sea and the Indian Ocean.
Cette traite déportait les esclaves en direction du Maghreb, d'une part, de l'Égypte, d'autre part. Et ces esclaves ensuite étaient répartis soit dans les pays musulmans, soit dans des pays chrétiens tels que l'Espagne, l'Italie, ou alors partaient beaucoup plus loin vers des pays du Moyen-Orient par la Syrie ou voire l'Arabie Saoudite à partir de l'Égypte.
We were brought to the Emirates or brought to the Gulf region during the 16th century and beyond. Slaves were assets and they were exchanged, they were sold. They were bartered, they were given as gifts. Slaves were commodities. Many of our ancestors worked as divers. It was really harsh. Pearl diving was the only product before oil. And in the off season, many went into the palm cultivation. And did also build ships and participated in various activities that had helped the country gain its economic strength and sustained the population that owned the slaves.
African descendants are also found in Iran, across the Persian Gulf from the Emirates.
The majority of these Africans were disembarked at various ports in Iran, southern parts. A few number were taken inland. Afro-Iranians were able to sustain and maintain African tradition. There are, for example, different practices, ceremonies. One of them, they call it actually Zar. The same name Zar we can see in Ethiopia. A lot of Islamic and Iranian elements were incorporated within this African culture, which basically created a new form of identity for Afro-Iranians.
African descendants are also found throughout the world of the Indian Ocean.
I'm actually looking at the ocean itself as the highway for the migration. In this case, by and large, the forced migration, the movement of people as merchandise across a highway that actually connects Asia and Africa. Certainly places like the Maldives, which are mid-oceanic island chains, they are the sort of places where people have to go through that chain in order to get to, say, Sri Lanka or the west coast of India. And certainly, if they want to go to the east coast of India, into the Bay of Bengal, it's hardly surprising, given the location of the Maldives and the ancient seafaring tradition, that there would be Africans there. The other point is also the Maldives were the source of the currency used not only in the Indian Ocean but the Atlantic to purchase Africans, the cowrie shells. And these cowrie shells were transported, for example, by the East India Company to London to be passed over to London's trading, slave trading firms. So there are definitely links there that span a huge long period of time.
When Europeans began enslaving people to develop the islands of the Indian Oceans, Africans, although not the only victims, were of the vast majority. The island of Mauritius, because of its strategic location, played a key role in the global slave trade.
Une des particularités de la traite d'esclaves dans l'océan Indien, c'est que la population civile n'était pas composée uniquement d'esclaves africains. Il y avait aussi une traite d'esclaves issus de l'Inde et du sud-est asiatique. Ainsi, par exemple, au Mascareigne, il a été estimé qu'environ 13% des esclaves étaient issus soit de l'Inde ou du sud-est asiatique. Et on connaît en outre l'importance des esclaves malais au Cap de Bonne-Espérance sous l'occupation néerlandaise. Il faut aussi souligner l'importance de Madagascar dans les réseaux de traite établis dans l'océan Indien, d'où l'importance des éléments culturels malgaches dans la culture des îles créoles de l'océan Indien.
East Africans from the Horn in the north to Mozambique in the south also migrated to or were taken to various parts of India, where they're collectively known as Siddhis.
We are proud to be Siddhi. During Nizam period, he brought some people from Africa for his army.
Our people are brought to India at 800 years ago. We are come as a slaves, as a soldier, and as a businessman.
Of the many Africans enslaved to be soldiers for rulers, some acquired surprising roles.
This was the one place in the world where black Africans ruled over non-Africans outside of Africa. And I found, in fact, that there were several places where this happened. And this was well documented in coins, stamps, photographs, great paintings in the great museums of the world. I first saw Africans when I saw paintings of Malik Ambar. And Malik Ambar was a great general who basically controlled a sultanate called Ahmednagar. He came to India as a slave. His master had 500 slaves and may have been an African himself. He became the ruler of this country, and he was the biggest opponent of the Mughal emperor, as the Mughal emperors tried to conquer most of India.
Siddhis were also known for their architecture in several areas of India. The most famous Siddhi architectural structure, which is one of India's national landmarks, is the island fort of Janjira. Ruled by the Siddhi royal family of the princely state of Janjira, The fort controlled the waters of India's Konkani coast from the 17th century until 1948, after India's independence. Although Afro-Indians don't usually come to mind when one thinks of communities of the African diaspora, many cities are quite aware of links with others two oceans away.
Black American and we are brothers.
Africans were also found throughout the vast Ottoman Empire that lasted from the 16th to the 19th century.
Well, we're talking about all the Middle East, that is to say, what is today Syria, Lebanon, Egypt is very important in this case, North Africa except Morocco, Morocco was never Ottoman, and the Balkans. The Ottomans enslaved both Caucasians, so they had white slaves, and they enslaved Africans. There are descendants of Africans in Turkey today. We know of African communities along the western coast of Turkey, that's the Aegean coast, and also along the Mediterranean coast.
The African presence in much of the Arab Muslim world is, however, much older than the slave trade. The Indian Ocean and the Red Sea were lively places of contact and exchange between peoples of Africa, Asia, and the Middle East, long before the search for spices and new horizons brought Europeans to these regions.
Nous avons été d'une école qui a toujours fondé le peuplement de l'Afrique du Nord sur les apports méditerranéens. Et nous avons oublié le continental, qui est à la base du peuplement de l'Afrique. Et l'archéologie, c'est l'histoire ancienne, la préhistoire, est là pour nous montrer à quel point le peuplement de l'Afrique du Nord a été commandé, déterminé dans une large mesure par les flux migratoires venant du Sud. Et le fond, le substrat africain, il est là avant tout.
And in Morocco, in North Africa, the Gnawa, whose ancestors were brought across the Sahara, are respected for their mastery of interactions with spiritual beings and their ability as talented healers. The Europeans who enslaved Africans in their colonies in the Americas had actually begun enslaving them in Europe in the mid-15th century, more than 50 years before developing the transatlantic slave trade.
The Portuguese peoples were the first of the Europeans to be engaged in the human traffic in Africa. The first cargo of African slaves went to Lisbon in the 1440s, I think it was 1444, and this began a very active process of trading in West Africa and West Central Africa by the Portuguese peoples. And they played a very fundamental role in the making of modern Europe. The British also, incidentally, had a number of African slaves. We don't think of England being a place where Africans existed as slaves, but when the British abolished slavery in 1772, there were probably as many as 20,000 Africans who were then enslaved in that nation.
To justify enslaving Africans, all kinds of religious, scientific, and intellectual arguments were used. The Church defined Africans as soulless savages who could only be saved by being brought to Christianity, even if they were worked to death in the process.
The Portuguese, for example, would baptize their captives before loading them on to slave ships. So, but you know, to understand this as a kind of religious conversion is in fact obscene. And we also know that from places like Congo, what Christian conversion meant in Africa was actually the expansion of the slave trade. So the conversion of the Congo kingdom to Catholicism actually opened up that kingdom to the slave trade, and those Catholic converts were primarily involved in the slave trade.
Scientists invented the concept of race and developed theories of racial hierarchy and of the congenital inferiority of blacks, which became the basis of European racism. Africans were said to have no history, no culture, no civilization.
Hubo una distorsión en la historia, que la historia fue cambiada a propósito. Entonces, para justificar la compra y venta de esclavos, ¿no? Suponía que eran personas que no eran personas.
In no instance were the other groups racially stigmatized by the enslavement. Whereas with the enslaved African population, this stigmatization became a global phenomenon in and of itself.
In the slavery systems of Africa and elsewhere, the humanity of enslaved people was generally assumed. Sometimes they could be integrated in the enslavers' families, rise to position of power, even become royals. The system of slavery that Europeans created in the Americas was unique in that it became very quickly racialized. After the failure of the enslavement of native populations, only Africans were enslaved in the Americas. This system of chattel slavery sought to dehumanize its African victims. The millions of Africans torn away from the continent during almost 400 years and their generations of descendants were not defined as human beings. The French and Spanish Black Codes, laws that were written to regulate slavery, defined them as movable property. And the United States Constitution characterized them as 3/5 of a person.
In the European language, what we see is the birth of human commodities, right? That slaves are defined by their capacity to work, or that they're defined as a kind of, you know, money equivalent. The effort to kind of to strip Africans of their humanity is actually seen in this early language that's used to describe what a slave is. And it's a commodity that's equivalent to other commodities.
Packed tightly into the holds of ships like other merchandise, almost 1/5 of these Africans perished in the inhuman conditions of their horrific journey across the ocean. A journey that could last from 6 weeks to more than 2 months, depending on the points of departure and arrival and the weather. Upon arrival, they were sold at public auctions. Upon purchase, their existence was recorded not on human population censuses, but on their owners' property lists, along with cows, pigs, horses, and household furniture.
Véritablement, on est dans le cadre de l'esclavage le plus dur qui ait existé et sans véritablement d'issue.
Enslaved Africans who survived the arduous crossing sometimes had life expectancies of only 7 years due to the harsh conditions of enslavement. The need for constant replacements fueled the trade, and owners of enslaved people and the investors who financed the many aspects of the trade reaped huge financial rewards.
Generally speaking, ordinary people were in the forefront of the trade. In the early years, when monopoly companies were active, monopoly rights were granted to some aristocratic participants, such as the English royal family members who founded the Company of Royal Adventurers trading to Africa in the 17th century. But I don't think that such people contributed much to the growth of the slave trade. It was ordinary people looking for areas of profitable investments who expanded the trade.
La seule colonie de Saint-Domingue, la seule partie française, donc la partie occidentale de Saint-Domingue, aujourd'hui République d'Haïti, faisait vivre un Français sur 8. Et qui faisait vivre un Français sur 8? Eh bien, 500 000 esclaves. J'avais fait le calcul que chaque esclave faisait vivre 5 ou 6 Français.
La majorité du commerce français se faisait avec Saint-Domingue, c'était la plus riche colonie du monde. Le commerce de Saint-Domingue, qui était environ 60% du commerce français, était, était un commerce considérable. Et certainement, Saint-Domingue a fait la richesse des villes côtières, ou en particulier Bordeaux, Nantes, etc., qui vivaient du commerce de Saint-Domingue.
The wealth produced by Haiti was based on sugar, the most valuable commodity coming into Europe in the 18th century.
To get a comparator for today's world, if you compare sugar to oil, you begin to understand the geopolitical significance of sugar at that time in the country. 1807-1700s, there was a ravenous, almost rabid demand for sugar right throughout Western Europe. And the sugar industry became of such geopolitical importance that France and the United Kingdom in particular regularly went to war against each other for the domination of Caribbean plantations and sugar colonies.
Rice, another major Atlantic commodity, is usually assumed to be Asian. But West Africans also independently domesticated rice. US planters would ask slave ship captains to bring them both rice seeds and rice negroes, familiar with the complex technology of growing it. This African rice, cultivated in the United States, based on African expertise, provided financial backing for the South in the U.S. Civil War.
It is very interesting that South Carolina was the first colony to secede from the Union. The colony's wealth was first based on rice. And rice, in this sense, was as important to the development of the South in the colonial period as sugar was to England in the same period of time.
Much of Atlantic slavery took the form of a triangular trade. Merchandise produced in Europe was shipped to Africa to be exchanged for Africans to be shipped to the Americas to produce raw materials to be shipped to Europe. It was from cities such as Lisbon, Seville, Amsterdam, London, Liverpool, Nantes, and Bordeaux, but also Rio de Janeiro, Bahia, Havana, and Newport, that ships left for Africa and to which they returned with the riches of the Americas.
Durante todo o tempo, enquanto houve escravidão, houve luta contra a escravidão. E que foi sistema que se reproduziu tendo como conteúdo necessário ao próprio escravismo o uso da violência permanente contra a população negra. Então, resistência é muito isso. É recuperar e quebrar este silêncio que foi construído em torno da passividade ou da aceitação da escravidão pelos escravos, ou pelos africanos, com as várias argumentações de que a escravidão era conhecida na África, ou que os africanos eram mais habituados ao trabalho sedentário, ao trabalho organizado. Tudo isso é uma forma de justificar a escravidão.
Africans resisted first within Africa. In Angola, Queen Nzinga fought a more than 30-year war against Portuguese slave traders until they negotiated a treaty with her in 1656. However, some kings agreed to trade with the Europeans and took personal benefit from the slave trade by strengthening their power with imported firearms. Other Africans, refusing to be captured and sold to enslavers, resisted and ran away to places hard of access, like the Tofino people in Benin, who built their villages in the middle of lagoons.
Je peux parler du peuple Lobi. Qui a quitté donc le nord ouest du Ghana et à cause des rapts qu'exerçaient des royaumes du Ghana actuel, plutôt que de continuer à pratiquer une guerre de guérilla contre des esclavagistes supérieurement armés alors qu'eux n'avaient que leurs arcs, ils ont utilisé leur architecture, c'est-à-dire que c'est des gens qui habitent dans des fermes closes. Des fermes à argamas, c'est-à-dire à terrasse, avec une seule ouverture d'entrée, une petite ouverture d'entrée, en forme de triangle, qui ne laisse passer qu'une personne à la fois. Les gens qui sont abrités à l'intérieur ont tout le temps de voir venir l'ennemi et de pouvoir se défendre. Et les chambres ne sont éclairées que par des petites ouvertures rondes. Donc ils peuvent surveiller comme ça l'environnement.
Segundo, uma resistência nos portos de embarque. Então não é à toa que os armazéns e as feitorias eram prisões. Durante a viagem havia várias rebeliões e nós temos notícias de vários navios que foram recuperados pelos escravos, onde o caso hoje mais comum é o caso que foi objeto de um filme chamado Amistade. E por fim, revoltas dos lugares de trabalho onde eles eram inseridos.
The first great African slave revolt historically documented took place in Iraq. Known as the Zanj Revolt, it lasted from 869 to 883. Thousands of African slaves from East Africa working in the salt marshes in southern Iraq joined forces with other groups to revolt against slavery and for social changes. The Zanj rebels even established their own state with its capital called Al-Muqtada. And during 14 years, seriously threatened and challenged the reign of the Abbasid Caliphate.
And this continued in the Americas when people found themselves in inhospitable milieus who were defined by those who owned them as property. And these people refused to accept that definition of themselves. If they had accepted it, then they would not have challenged the forces of oppression. But they began as early as 1522. In Santo Domingo, and there was an avalanche of rebellions throughout the 16th, 17th, and 18th centuries in Jamaica, in Mexico, in Cuba, in Brazil, in Venezuela, all over the diaspora, in the United States, or North America for that matter. But this kind of physical challenge to slavery was not restricted to rebellions. People ran away, escaped to inaccessible parts of these countries and established free settlements. The Maroons in Jamaica, for example, signed a peace treaty with the British in 1739 that recognized their freedom.
Yanga, que era de origen noble, se subió a, a las montañas de Orizaba y constituyó un palenque. Y tuvo varios de sus compañeros de lucha que encabezaron una resistencia armada, combatieron las fuerzas coloniales durante casi 40 años. Finalmente pactaron el virrey y Yanga la fundación de San Lorenzo de los Negros, que es el actual municipio de Yanga.
Now the Haitian Revolution, of course, is the most spectacular of the challenges to slavery. The only society in this hemisphere that was able to overthrow slavery by violent means. Of course, after that, they had to confront all kinds of efforts to nullify their freedom because Europeans became afraid that what happened in Haiti could happen in their backyard.
Haiti became the world's first black republic and the first republic in the Americas to abolish slavery. Haiti also successfully supported wars of independence led by Simon Bolivar in Latin America by providing strategic information, funds, and troops against Spanish colonialism. The quests for freedom by enslaved people began to be supported by increasingly influential groups of ordinary people in Europe and the Americas as they learned from former victims about the horrors of the system that was developing their nations, enriching their lives and forging their tastes. More and more leaders of abolitionist movements, such as William Wilberforce in England, Victor Schœlcher in France, and Frederick Douglass in the United States, campaigned to put an end to slavery.
This wonderful letter to the Parliament saying, "We, the steel workers of Sheffield, a very, very famous steel working town in the north of England, petition you to end this barbaric activity. We make the chains and we get the profits of selling shackles and other torture implements and enslavement implements to slave plantations worldwide. And you may think this is against our own interest, but we are still convinced that this trade should end, despite whatever economic impact it may have on us as workers.
After using tactics such as boycotting sugar produced by enslaved people, British abolitionists, in what was one of the first major human rights movement, convinced Parliament to declare in March 1807 the end of the Atlantic slave trade, although not Atlantic slavery, which lasted another 80 years.
Deux dernières remarques doivent être faites au sujet de ce long processus, de ce long siècle des abolitions de l'esclavage, qui dure, je le rappelle, donc de 1791, grande révolte des esclaves de Saint-Domingue, jusqu'en 1886 à Cuba, jusqu'en 1888 au Brésil. C'est, pour commencer, la faiblesse, la relative faiblesse des arguments des abolitionnistes occidentaux des 18e et 19e siècles. Leurs arguments sont essentiellement moraux ou religieux, ils sont très rarement économiques. Ils s'attaquent très rarement aux intérêts économiques, financiers, commerciaux qui sont en jeu. Ça fait bien sûr le jeu des planteurs qui, eux, sont en dialogue direct avec les pouvoirs centraux en général.
The movement to abolish the slave trade by the British as a response to humanitarianism is to tell only a part of the story. The British were beginning to transfer their capital from slaves to machines. The start of the Industrial Revolution was becoming quite evident.
Ironically, with the abolition of slavery, plantation owners, rather than the enslaved workers who had toiled so long for no pay, received financial compensation for the loss of this free labor force from governments, insurance companies, and even from the formerly enslaved.
If you take at the end of a period of slavery when slavery is abolished, the government placed £20 million in the early 1800s as compensation to plantation owners. I think the comparable figure today would be £3.5 billion, which is probably around $10 billion. That is the scale of compensation that was paid then.
Les esclaves, où que ce soit, ne percevront aucune indemnité. Aucune terre, aucun moyen de redémarrer économiquement, socialement. Quant à l'utilisation de cette indemnisation par les planteurs, il y a encore une grande différence entre l'utilisation britannique et l'utilisation française. Les Britanniques ne réinvestiront quasiment pas leur indemnisation sur place dans les colonies, alors que les planteurs français vont réinvestir une grande majorité de cette indemnité dans les colonies, puisqu'ils vont avoir création de banques à leur disposition, d'organismes de crédit qui vont permettre le développement de la monoculture sucrière, la construction de grandes usines.
In March 1855, the government of Peru paid former enslavers a total of 7,651,500 pesos. And in April 1862, when slavery was abolished in Washington, D.C., capital of the United States, the city paid $993,407 to compensate former owners for the loss of their human property. So, the same people who had benefited from slavery for centuries further benefited from its abolition. In exchange for agreeing to recognize Haiti's independence and encouraging other nations to do so, France forced Haiti to pay 150 million francs in gold to compensate the former plantation owners. It took Haiti a full century to pay the sum.
Malheureusement, après l'indépendance d'Haïti, nous étions complètement isolés, aucun pays ne nous reconnaissait à Haïti. Il fallait rétablir des relations, commercer avec les autres pays. Le président Boyer a accepté ces termes très durs que la France a posés pour sa reconnaissance, cette dette extérieure considérable qui parlait les sommes d'aujourd'hui s'élèverait à des dizaines de milliards de dollars. Cela nous a causé, à travers le 19e siècle, de graves problèmes.
If African slavery in the mines and plantations of its colonies created enormous wealth and power for Europe and parts of the Americas, it also led to the underdevelopment of Africa. centuries of trans-Saharan and transatlantic slave trades systematically destroyed African societies, economies, and cultures, the repercussions of which is still felt today by Africans and by the descendants of enslaved Africans everywhere.
C'est l'esclavage qui a fait les lits du retard actuel de l'Afrique, mais que sans restaurer cette mémoire, on ne peut pas savoir, par exemple, que il y a quatre siècles, l'Europe, une grande partie de l'Afrique, était économiquement sur le même pied d'égalité. Et que si on parle aujourd'hui de sous-développement, il y a des pays qui ont été des pays sous-développeurs, et ces pays étaient des pays européens.
Au XVIIIe siècle, la population était évaluée plus ou moins par les explorateurs et d'autres chercheurs. Et vers le XIXe siècle, il n'y avait plus qu'environ 200 millions d'habitants. En comparant l'habitat du XVIe siècle et celui du XIXe, on peut estimer que celui du XIXe siècle était trois fois moindre. Par conséquent, on peut estimer qu'au XVIe siècle, la population de l'Afrique subsaharienne, l'Afrique noire, était d'environ 600 millions d'habitants. Ce qu'elle a enduré, c'est une guerre de 100 ans qui a duré 300 ans avec les armes du XVIIe, XVIIIe et XIXe siècle.
The perspective and interpretive framework that people have brought to the study of the European or the colonization of the Americas is that it was principally a European enterprise. Demographically, however, this was not true. Between 1492 and 1776, or roughly the first 300 years of the so-called European colonization of the Americas, 6.5 million people crossed the Atlantic and settled in the Americas, North, Central, South America, and the Caribbean. Of those pioneer, if you will, 6.5 million people, only 1 million were European. The other 5.5 million were African, and that simple demographic fact requires that we change our perspective on how we understand both the nature of the so-called colonization of the Americas, but more importantly, the nature of the Americas themselves as they were transformed from a land populated principally by the Native American peoples to one populated by peoples from across the Atlantic.
Que demográficamente la población africana tuvo una importancia que no se conoce y no se ha difundido y no se ha asumido en la historia oficial. En el primer censo, el primer cálculo demográfico de México en el año de 1740, menos de 30.000 españoles, 400.000 indoafromestizos y cerca de 200.000 negros.
La participación de España en el tráfico negrero hacia el Caribe latino fue tardía, pero intensa, y violó los convenios firmados entre Inglaterra y España, primero el de 1817 y luego otro que se firmó en 1835. Esto fue un acto puramente formal porque, en definitiva, el tráfico siguió clandestinamente, ilegalmente, y los ingleses fabricaban barcos que fletaban con las mejores condiciones, pero las peores para los esclavos, y así llegaron al Caribe y particularmente a Cuba casi 2 millones de mujeres y hombres esclavizados, secuestrados, a trabajar acá, sobre todo en el primer lustro del siglo XIX y, bueno, finales ya del siglo XVIII, se incrementó mucho la introducción de africanos a nuestro país.
Most historians believe that the best way of trying to calculate the number of people who crossed the Atlantic to the Americas is actually to use records of ships. We're looking at probably somewhere close to 35 to 38,000 voyages. So our belief is now that we've captured most of the transatlantic slaving voyages. We're looking probably at a deportation of people of around 12 million, of whom about 85% survived the crossing.
Well, the principal implication is that much of what we've studied thus far about the Americas, especially its cultural development, is so heavily skewed on the European side that we've essentially missed the essence of the history and culture making that took place during that colonial epoch. And so it challenges those of us who are scholars and others who are interested in knowing the truth about this development of this hemisphere to go back to the sources and begin to piece together the cultural and political and social impact of the majority of the population that was here, rather than continuing to retell the stories of the minority, which basically is as much ideology as anything else.
The conspiracy of silence around the Atlantic slave trade led people to believe that little could be known about it and minimized its historical importance. In reality, because the slave trade and slavery were the basis of the extraordinarily lucrative commerce in the Atlantic world for centuries, the archives of slaving nations contain detailed records that testify to the enormity of that inhuman trade in human lives.
We can say a lot, far more than we ever anticipated we could, I think, about the age and gender patterns of those taken on board ship. So in the 17th century, we have a trade which is relatively balanced, but largely adult. By the 19th century, you get a trade which is very heavily male, usually two-thirds males to one-third females, but in which you also find a high proportion of children. Indeed, up to 50% of those entering the trade are seen as children.
The slave trade was a crime unprecedented in human history, in our view, and that's how we're categorizing it. It's simply incomparable with any other major crime in terms of its scale, its duration, and the barbarity of slavery.
Although many countries that benefited from African slavery still avoid dealing with this sensitive issue, some explicitly denying that it was a crime, at the 2001 United Nations World Conference Against Racism, Racial Discrimination, Xenophobia, and Related Forms of Intolerance, delegates from around the world also declared the slave trade and slavery a crime against humanity.
We acknowledge that slavery and the slave trade, including the transatlantic slave trade, were appalling tragedies in the history of humanity, not only because of their abhorrent barbarism, but also in terms of their magnitude, organized nature, and especially their negation of the essence of the victims.
France was the first nation to acknowledge the slave trade and slavery as a crime against humanity when on May 10, 2001, the French Parliament adopted what has come to be called the Taubira Law, proposed by Christiane Taubira, legislative representative from French Guyana. However, Haiti was the first nation to condemn slavery as a crime and to outlaw it in its legislation.
Cette masse de gens qui vivent sur le sol français a revendiqué une reconnaissance du passé esclave, de l'origine différente. Et c'est pour en fait la satisfaire que je pense la France, le gouvernement français a pensé à reconnaître enfin, après tant d'années, que l'esclavage était un crime contre l'humanité. On voudrait que cette date ne soit pas le seul symbole. On voudrait qu'il y ait aussi une refonte des livres d'histoire, surtout géographie aussi, économie même, et que dans ces livres, on intègre et la réalité de l'esclavage et ses conséquences sur le plan social, économique, comment finalement il a permis le développement des sociétés capitaliste européenne. On voudrait ça. Coming for to carry me
home, but still my soul. Une des choses qui a surpris les gens, c'est la profondeur de l'empreinte de l'Afrique dans les cultures des sociétés concernées. On connaissait par exemple l'apport des Africains à la culture, à la danse, à la musique. Mais plus les recherches étaient poussées, plus on se rendait compte que jusque dans la cuisine, les technologies, les savoir-faire, les croyances, les comportements psychologiques sont des choses qu'on ne comprendrait pas si on ne fait pas le détour par la traite négrière et par l'esclavage.
The other thing that we've been able to do now is to track the movements of people from particular parts of Africa through time to particular parts of the Americas. And that, I think, is a major breakthrough in terms of understanding not just the demographics of the trade, but the ethnic implications of the trade. And through all of that, of course, therefore, the cultural implications of transatlantic slavery.
Con la llegada de los negros esclavos, entre finales del siglo XVIII y principios del siglo XIX, acelerada en este proceso de esa llegada, se produce una simbiosis muy fuerte entre las culturas que ya existían en Cuba y las culturas africanas. Las religiones, las costumbres, la música. Esto es extraordinariamente importante en la cultura cubana. África marca la cultura cubana dando las características fundamentales de lo que somos los cubanos de hoy.
Hoy, a gente pode dizer que o Brasil é o segundo contingente de população negra de origem africana fora de África. Se misturaram no Brasil, criaram formas de solidariedade e de complementariedade interafricana. Eu estou falando de iorubás, estou falando de oxais, estou falando de populações vindas da atual Nigéria e Benin, os akans e bambaras, os peul, a grande massa majoritária de povos de ditos bantos, né? Que na verdade vêm da área do Reino do Congo e Angola.
Rather than being brought to the Americas as just unskilled laborers, many Africans were selected for the specialized expertise European and Euro-American slavers knew they had, such as rice cultivation and gold mining in areas of West Africa.
When I talk about a system of knowledge, it is this thinking about how it was in the 18th century when most of the world's people were rural and agriculture was a fact of life. We forget in this highly urbanized, modernized world in which we live, we forget the significance of knowing how to use land in different kinds of environments. It was you lived or died by that knowledge. Looking at the period of plantation slavery and looking at the food systems in this way sheds new light, I believe, on the immensity of the contribution of enslaved peoples to the agricultural history of the Americas.
Outros na grande tradição da mineração. Não é à toa que quando a se instala, digamos assim, uma corrida do ouro em Minas Gerais, de 1700 em diante, né? Se começa a ter que buscar negros minas, que vinham de Elmina.
African technological contributions to the development of the Americas remain largely unacknowledged, camouflaged by the pervasive racism resulting from slavery that has denied African expertise and accomplishments.
The legacies of transatlantic slavery are still with us, and there are issues arising from that legacy that still need to be addressed in terms of recognizing the human trauma, the psychological problems that the descendants of slaves have suffered as a result of their ancestors' movements, forced movement across the Atlantic. This is a process which continues to have repercussions for opportunities, for expectations of people and so on throughout the Atlantic world.
This issue of racism which came out of the slave trade and slavery has affected the whole of humanity. It has marked the culture, especially the Western culture, but not only the Western culture. It has marked the whole world.
La ligne de partage entre blanc et noir dans la terminologie c'est esclave, abd, et hor, blanc. Alors, quand on rétorque à ces personnes, mais comment, pourquoi dites-vous que c'est un abd? C'est un homme noir. Pourquoi vous ne dites pas un homme noir? Ah oui, c'est vrai. Mais en fait, abd, ça ne veut pas dire esclave, ça veut dire noir tout court. Mais ils restent marqués de par leur peau comme étant des descendants d'esclaves, même s'il s'agit de noirs récemment immigrés dans le pays.
Il y a encore des réticences, il y a encore certaines régions où cette question est encore une question taboue, où c'est encore une question qu'on n'évoque pas facilement. Mais je crois que ces appréhensions disparaîtront petit à petit, parce que les populations qui sont concernées par la traite négrière demanderont de plus en plus à ce que cette mémoire-là aussi soit ramenée à la surface.
Evidence is literally coming to the surface of both earth and sea. In many cities, people walk today on streets paved by profits made on the backs of enslaved people. In New York City, people literally walk over the skeletal remains of enslaved Africans and their descendants who helped build the city and are buried in the African burial ground that lies under Wall Street, the financial capital of the world. And on both sides of the Atlantic, in the waters of the southern United States off the coast of Florida and of northern Europe off the coast of Norway, excavations of two wrecked slave ships, the Henrietta Mary and the Fredensborg, have revealed previously buried stories. Research is revealing both unsuspected cultural connections within the diaspora and ways in which people and culture of African origin have influenced those they met. Similar cultural elements found their way from Africa to distant parts of the world. The Malunga, played by the cities of Gujarat across the Indian Ocean, is clearly the cousin of the Berimbau, played by Afro-Brazilians across the Atlantic. Despite the less than enviable way in which Africans left the continent to spread across the world in the second diaspora, they became the first globalized peoples of the modern era, a human and cultural link between Africa, the continent of human origins, and Asia and the Middle East, Europe, and all of the Americas. Forced to recreate themselves in strange lands among unknown people under intolerable circumstances, these Africans and their descendants triumphed over an intensity and duration of oppression unprecedented in human history. By understanding this silent chapter of world history, we can better grasp the genealogy binding the slave trade to other crimes against humanity and new forms of enslavement.